पवित्रवतु।
Welcome to the lecture on embryology. I'll be talking on I'll be introducing a topic of embryology to you, a bit smaller topic, not going into the detail of it. It's about unicellular to multicellular. Okay. Embryology, I have told you, it is a study of embryo, right? And embryo means unborn, the thing which is not taken birth. When it takes birth, what do you call? Fetus, right? Fetus. Or just before birth, also you can call fetus when the organs are formed. Okay. But before that, there is a common terminology that is used is the embryo. Okay. And the study of formation of embryo is called as the embryology. Okay. You can see the picture diagram over there. A small embryo of a vertebrate. Okay. This is the general outline of the life cycle of an adult vertebrate. There is a gender difference, male and female, they mate and they give birth to the young one. Okay. The blue square what you see, this one, is the study of embryology. Okay. Animals below annelids, okay, most of the animals, they are hermaphrodites, mean sexes are same. Only in one individual you get male organ as well as female organ. Whereas as you go upwards, higher organism from arthropods, you will get genders, male and female. And there's a difference between male and female as you go higher, and you can easily identify with the male, with the female, whereas in hermaphrodite it is not possible. Okay. But the first and primary state you need to understand in the embryology is the fertilization. Now, what is fertilization? It is a fusion of
male and female.
Okay. What is the male gamete called? Sperm. And female gamete?
Ovum.
Inside the structure, you know, structure of a gamete, there's a nucleus. In case of male, in case of sperm, there's a nucleus. After there is a mid piece, followed by a tail. And something above the nucleus, that is called as?
Acrosome.
Acrosome, right? What is the function of acrosome?
To secrete enzymes.
Right, secrete the enzymes for?
Penetration through the zone.
Right, the enzyme called hyaluronidase. It is secreted by the breaking of the acrosomal gap, and that enzyme digests the lipid bilayer of the ovum, okay, and the sperm can get the nuclei of the sperm can get in the contact with the ovum, okay. Nucleus followed by midpiece. What is the midpiece?
Mitochondria.
Function?
Energy supply.
Provide energy, right? And tail?
Motility.
That is motility of the sperm, right? And in ovum, how does it look? What is the shape of the ovum?
Spherical
oval, okay. Inside there is a nucleus, right? Then what?
Large amount of cytoplasm.
Large amount of cytoplasm, yes. And then? Anything else? Graphene
follicle.
No. It is a part of ovary, okay. In ovum, you get nucleus, large amount of cytoplasm, which contains good quantity of yolky material, which provides nutrition to the developing embryo. Okay, and anything else? Do you get Golgi body in the ovum? You know what is Golgi body? Okay, it is that in the ovum, right? So, in case of hermaphrodite animal, how do they fertilize?
Cross
pollination.
Self-fertilization, cross
pollination. Okay, what is self-fertilization? That is, sperm and ovum the same individual they fuse, right? And in case of cross-fertilization, you get two separate individuals meeting with each other. In case of vertebrate, which type you get? Which type of fertilizer you get?
Cross.
It has to be cross because the sexes are separate. Okay. Female cannot reproduce on her own. Okay, it requires sperm. Right? Do you know any type of production where male is not required?
Parthenogenesis.
Very good. Parthenogenesis, where a female on her own can reproduce. There is no need of male. Okay. You know any example of any animal?
Desert.
Yeah, there are desert lizards. Very few vertebrate examples are there. Mostly, most example you get them in the invertebrates. Okay. And in case of parthenogenetic animals, the young ones, they are literally genetic clones of the female because there is no genetic diversity involved. The female directly deoxes a gene and produces the young one. Okay. So, cross fertilization and self fertilization. In case of cross fertilization, what is the advantage?
If it is gene variation.
In case of, yeah, very good. Variation of what?
Genetic material, genotype.
Yeah, genes are exchanged. So, I hope you heard terminology called gene pool, which is a total sum of the gene of that species. So, that becomes larger, highly diverse, and because of cross fertilization. Okay? Cross fertilization means polygamy or polyandry. That you will find in many organisms, but in higher organisms, there are few examples. Even in birds, you get monogamy or monoandry. Okay, some birds they pair only in the once in a lifetime, and the pair remains constant throughout. So in that case, the number of individuals is less, because they can devote large amount of energy in raising the young one. Okay. Fertilization in case of vertebrates, it is external, right? Or internal? It is internal, means it occurs inside the body of the female, right? Do you know any externally fertilizing animal?
Frog.
In case of fish, right? In case of birds, see, in case of internally fertilizing organisms, male produces a copulating organ, a penis. But in birds, there is male doesn't have a penis, but still fertilization is internal. Okay. Once the fertilization is done, what you get is a union of two gametes. Okay. Now, how does a gamete form? It is formed from the testes and ovaries. What is the basic similarity between two gametes? A male gamete and a female gamete?
Both are
haploid. Means they have
one
end, that is single set of chromosomes. So, when the two sexes they come together, they become diploid. In vertebrates, N alone cannot survive. Because you must have heard of terminology called alleles and all that. So they require a partner to express. A single set of genome cannot sustain. Okay, so this is the general outline I told you. What is the fusion of male and female gamete called?
Zygote.
It is zygote. Zygote is again another origin in Latin language, that is the union or a fusion. Okay. Fertilization, that is a fusion of male and female gametes, that is sperm and ovum. The nuclei of the male gamete and female gamete, they are haploid, N, right? They are called as the pro nuclei. Pro means
before.
So when they fuse, it becomes a a newly born nuclei, a proper nuclei with two end number. Okay. Have you heard of terminology biological clock?
Yes.
What is that? See, in every individual, there is a clock set by the genome, and it will decide that how much time you will survive. Okay. So, your biological age is different and physical age is different. Once the male and female pronuclear fuse, at the same time, your biological clock starts. okay, and that is why probably the dolly sheep, she expired or died at an
six.
Supposedly early stage, because she was cloned from a mother. Okay, she was not formed by the fusion of two gametes. Old gamete from the female has been taken and introduced into a enucleated cell and allowed to undergo cleavage. Okay, so the biological age of that nucleus was already of the age of the
mother.
So biologically, Dolly was of the age of her mother, but physically, she was younger. Okay, so as the age progressed, she suffered old age diseases and all that. Okay, so this is biological law. Now there is some logical thing I want you to think over it. Why ovum doesn't move? The sperms, they move with the help of tail. Ovum does not. It is on the place because of it is heavy, large amount of cytoplasm and other cellular organisms. But why it has to be remain on its place?
Waiting for sperm to come.
Okay. See, the reason is ovum is a kind of place which is going to form an embryo, not the sperm. Sperm is just a mean to carry the male egg. And just insert it into the ovum, which is having single female egg. Okay, so the function of male gamete or sperm is only to inject the remaining cell of the DNA into the ovum, and afterwards the ovum or the sperm degenerates. I hope you know that once it attaches to the ovum, releases pronuclear, rest is shedded off, degenerates on its own. Okay, so when there is a fusion of pronuclei, you get zygote, and then zygote undergoes cleavage and all that, and it forms a embryo. Okay, so that's why the ovum is already provided with everything required for basic development and not the sperm. Are you getting it? Okay. Okay. So fertilization, that is the fusion of. Do you know what is the fusion of male and female pronuclei called? It is called as amphimixis, right? Amphi is to
mixes.
Okay, two genome, they mix. And what you get at the end of fertilization is a single cell zygote. It undergoes different processes and you get multicellular embryo. It undergoes organogenesis, that is formation of generation of organs. You get fetus, which takes birth into the world. Okay. The zygote is also called an egg. Okay, don't confuse with the chicken what you eat. Okay, of course it is an egg. There are different types of eggs. As I told you, the ovum is provided with the nourishment for the future embryo, the yolk and all that. So depending on the position of the yolk and placement of the yolk, the eggs are divided into different categories. All of you must be eating chicken, right? So you see a big, bulky, yellow yolk inside. Okay. Have you tested any other egg? Rather, in birds, you will find a similar structure. It has a very large quantity of yolk. So it is called as what? Megalocytum. Megalocytum. There is another called mesolocytum, where intermediate quantity, and there is a microlocytum, where very little quantity. Okay? Now logically you tell me why bird egg has a shell around it and why fish egg doesn't have shell around it. Are you getting the question?
Moisture.
The fish egg, have you seen fish egg? Okay, you can see literally nucleus inside, cytoplasm. Even after fertilization, you will see developing embryo pick up inside. That you cannot see in bird egg. Okay. Now, why bird egg is having shell. By the way, the eggs which are having shells, they are called as the cleloid egg. Cleloid egg. And those who doesn't have, they are called as the non-cleloid eggs. Now the reason is, in case of fish, fertilization is
extraction.
Right? So the female lays eggs in the water, and the male sheds sperms on it, and they fuse. In case of worm, fertilization is
internal.
It occurs in the duct of the female. Okay, so already fertilization has taken inside the body of the female. What water in the sea or in the river performs the function for fish egg? There are some secretions. You find it in a female ovida. They give the egg moist. pH level is maintained, so the sperm will not die. It will typically reach the egg. So once zygote is formed, there is no need to the zygote is about to be laid outside the body of the bird. In case of, you must have studied placental mammals. No? We are placental mammals, means the female inside in the uterus, she holds the embryo and develops, gives the nourishment inside it through the placenta. That doesn't happen in non-placental organisms like birds. Okay, so the egg is laid outside, and female only has to take care of the egg. Right? You must have seen it on TV. So there is no nourishment after the egg is laid. So it is already provided with large quantity of yolk. That doesn't happen with the mammals. There is an umbilical cord, there is a placenta which constantly gives nourishment and protection to the embryo. Okay? So we'll proceed ahead. What we have got is a single cell zygote, that is a fusion of male and female nuclei. So 2n number is restored. Okay? This is it, what I was talking. I have given two different colors just to make you understand. The process of formation of gamete is called gametogenesis, spermatogenesis, and oogenesis. But I will just tell you the names of the different states. First is spermatogonium, then you get primary spermatocyte, secondary spermatocyte, then you get spermatozoa and spermatids. Okay? In case of oogonium, it is almost similar. Oogonium, primary oocyte, secondary oocyte, and last is ovum. Okay? Now which type of division takes place? Nuclear division?
Meiotic.
That is reduction division. Okay? Once the gamete is formed, at a stage before it, there is a n number because of meiosis. But this number of the gamete has to increase. So it again undergoes mitotic division to increase the number of cells. So one single germinal epithelial cell of a male produces 16 of 8 to 16 sperms from single cell, where in case of female you get only one of. Okay, why so? Because energy requirement for the formation of sperm is less. It requires only macrosome, neocolonuclei, mitochondria, and tail. Plus, in case of ovum, you require large amount of cytoplasm and other basic cell organelles. Okay? So, at the end, what you get is a zygote. It is a single cell. All of us have developed from single cell zygote. Now, which is the next step? First step towards the formation of multicellular.
Cleavage.
Very good. What is cleavage? Okay, I'll just tell you the different stages. After zygote, then we'll go to the cleavages. Zygote undergoes cleavage, and what you get is the morula. Okay, what is morula? I'll tell you in coming class. Morula undergoes cleavage and rearrangement of cells to produce to form blastula. It again undergoes cleavage, rearrangement, and morphogenetic movements to form gastrula. Gastrula undergoes same, but lastly is the neurulation, that is the formation of central nervous system what we made is a neuron. Okay, now let us go with the cleavage. Okay, this is how cleavage goes. You see the number of that is diploid is maintained, 2n number. Okay, so first step in formation of cleavage is what?
Karyokinesis
means. Just see the figure. What is happening in the figure? Nuclear divides mitotically, right? You get two nucleus, and before there is a separation, the cytokinesis starts. Okay, and cytoplasm starts dividing itself, and at the end, what you get is a daughter cells. That is having 2n. So from one cell, you have what? 2 cells. Okay. Now the size has to reduce. Okay, because nobody is nourishing this cell from externally, so it will reduce. Okay. This was a section I showed you. It looks like this a little bit. Single cell has undergone cleavage and it has produced a ball of cells. Okay, so cleavage is a very important step from conversion from unicellularity to multicellularity. We are multicellular organism, so there has to be millions, trillions of cells. This cannot be done with only single cell, so it has to undergo division, redivision. Okay, now have you studied embryology anywhere before in 12th? Okay, we'll go on. The first step immediately after the cleavage is morula. You must have heard of fruit called mulberry. It is not common here, but the similar fruit I will ask you to imagine is a custard apple. Sitapad. Okay, it is a ball of cells. Even if you take TS, that is transverse section, it is a what you can say, there is no cavity inside. Okay, so that is a morula. It is a very short lived stage, it does not live more than few half an hour or 1 hour or 2 hours, not more than that. And the cells themselves rearrange themselves to form a cavity in between, that is called as the blastocoel. So, what you get is a blastula having a cavity inside. Okay, it is filled with the cellular secretions, it is not a airtight, I mean, hollow cavity, it is filled with liquid. Okay. Now I told you there is a yolk in the embryo, this zygote. Okay, so yolk is a non-cellular part. Clear? Non-cellular part means it is non-living part. It will not divide. Okay, only living part, that is a cell, also called as the germ cells, they will divide, redivide. Okay. So the presence of yolk in the cell decides the rate of cleavage. Decides the rate of cleavage. If the yolk quantity is high, rate of cleavage is low. If it is less, it is more. Okay. This is how blastula looks at the later stage. This is the TS of blastula. Inside you will see a big cavity called blastocoel. It is a kind of pulse-like structure which is having a straight or a straight, what you can say, a floor and roof, curved roof. It is made up of entirely cells, and this is how in section they look like. This is a example I am giving you from the frog. Okay, frog blastula. It looks like this. Now, this is called as the animal pole. This is called as vegetal. This is called vegetal pole because it is having, look at the size of the cells, it is having large quantity of yolk, and this is having less quantity of yolk or rather no yolk. Okay, so you get high rate of cleavage here, less rate of cleavage here, and the cells are smaller because yolk is less. They are called as the micrometers, and these are called as the megameres. Okay. You see the arrow. Okay, now blastula, the next step after blastula is gastrulation. It is a, okay, how many layer of blastula is? It is single layer, there is no cell layer differentiation. Okay, just coming back to basics, in our body, how many layers are there?
Three.
What are those?
Outermost
is? Ectoderm. Did you get? Now, in blastula stage, there is no layer. Later on, as stage, I mean the development proceeds, there is a formation of layers. Okay. Now, gastrulation, these are the salient features of gastrulation process. What is gastrula? That I'll tell you in coming discussion. Cleavage is there in the gastrula. Okay. Remember, zygote is dividing, redividing, redividing, but its final size is not increasing. This you keep in mind. Otherwise, the hem egg movement would have become something like this and again shortened down. So, it is because there is no extra nourishment from outside. What is happening is inside that shell. Okay, so the final result and size remains same. Okay, so the rate of cleavage is very high from modula to late blastula, even in the gastrula for that matter, because a layer has to be formed, three layers have to be formed, so the embryo needs more and more cells, so they are provided by the high rate of cleavage. Okay, then at this stage the nuclei takes over. Nuclei, all of you know, that is the central governing body of the cell. Till this stage the things are programmed. Okay, from the birth. Okay, they have to happen. But at this stage, nuclei starts, they get woken up and okay, I have to do this. The nuclei starts taking over the entire process. Chemodifferentiation starts, means the cells internally, they start synthesizing some chemicals so that the cells of brain, they will become chemically different. Cells of gut, they will become chemically different. Okay, so that is called the chemodifferentiation. In gastrulation, you will get three germinal layers, the same ecto, meso, and endo. Okay, then what you get is the entero posterior polyari. Means the embryo gets directed, gets the final shape, which is the anterior side, which is the posterior side. Anterior side is also called a cephalic side, that is towards the head. And posterior side is also called a caudal side. Okay, towards the tail side. Okay. And last is, it starts attaining, what is that?
Bilateral.
We are bilaterally symmetrical organisms. So at this stage, the symmetry happens. How that we will see. This stage, that is called a gastrula, is called, okay, incoming slides, I'll explain. Gastrulation is a bit complicated process. There are two basic types of processes involved, and those are called as the morphogenetic movements. Okay, morpho is what? Shape, not structure. Structure is another. Morpho is outline. Morphology is study of outer. Okay, so morphogenetic means formation of shape takes place with the movement of those cells. So how you can define the definitive programmed movement of the cells to the respective position of their fate? Okay, so that is called as the morphogenetic movement. There are two basic types of movements, epiboly and emboly. In blastula stage, you can map the fate of the cells. Have you heard of fate maps? Fate map is a theoretical mapping of the blastula and which area, cells in which area are going to form what in the future. That is all programmed, it's not haphazard. Okay. So what scientists have done is they have injected some a dye into the cell, a group of cells. Okay, and they keep on observing through the microscope or take a photo after regular interval. And find that a cell which was present at the vagal pole is migrating somewhere ahead anterior, and in future it's going to form part of nervous system. In some cells will go deep inside into the zygote, into the blastula, and they will form the endoderm. Okay, so their fate is already, you can map it on the blastula, that is called the fate map. So according to their fate, this movement starts. It is not random, not haphazard. Okay, so there are two types of basic types of movement, that is epibody, that is growth and overlapping, and next is embody, okay, migration of cells. Now this is epibody. This is again, I am giving example of a frog. You remember which was the pole at the top called?
Animal pole.
Animal pole. Lower is the vegetal pole. Now I told you, amount of yolk decides the rate of cleavage. So cells at the animal pole, they will redivide very fast. Okay? Because there is no yolk. And what happens is, see, when they are dividing and redividing, they cannot overgrow on the embryo and form a horn-like structure. It is not required, not possible, because they have cell adhesion as well. They know each other's presence. So what happens is, they start multiplying and they start enveloping the embryo. Okay, from sideways. Now this is animal pole, this is vegetal pole. At particular place here, the cells are almost absent. The yolk inside the cell, you can see popping out. Okay, it doesn't empty out of the blastula. It is present. You can see here, it is called as the yolk pillar. The yolk is present there. So what happens is all the cells under epibody, they divide, redivide, and they come here at this part. And till this stage, it is only one layer. Now at this place, what happens is this, they come inside the embryo. They come this is okay, so this is the blastopore region. The yolk, you can see, it is from this side. It is not a liquid state, so it doesn't fall out of the embryo. Okay, now the cells which are rapidly dividing, they move like this. They come here and they go inside. Okay, now here you get start forming the third layer. Here you get first layer, second layer, and this cell which are going inside will form the third layer. Okay, now this region is called as the dorsal leaf. Dorsal leaf, that is the leaf of the blastopore. It is like a mouth, okay, open mouth, and this is like a leaf region. So the cells will come here and they will go inside. And why it is called dorsal? Because what is their animal pole, in future it is going to form dorsal side, and vegetal pole is going to form future ventral side. Okay. So this is called as the dorsal leaf. The cells will move like this. Eventually, they will not move from the lower leaf, ventral leaf. They will move only from the sides and from the dorsal leaf inside. Okay, lower side is remain as it is for a while, and then finally the number of cells increase so much that they attack from all sides. Okay. Now this region of the dorsal leaf is called as Spemann organizer. Spemann organizer. It was discovered by the scientist. If you remove this region of the dorsal leaf, that is Spemann organizer, at this stage, and you transplant it somewhere else, anywhere on the embryo, the cell will move to that region and they will go inside in that region. Are you getting it? If you cut this region, dorsal leaf, and transplant it somewhere else on the embryo, the cells will identify where is that, and they will reach there and they will go inside from there. So they identify that region. It is basically an organizer, as name suggests. It organizes the inward movement of the cells. Okay. Now imagine this is like a door. You open the door and the students they come in and sit into the class. Okay, something like this. If door is on that side, students will definitely go there. They will not come from the window, right? So this is Spearman organizer. Okay, so that is epibody. Epi above, so which covers the ball of that embryo, epibody or envelope. Okay. Now there are 5 steps, sub-steps involved in gastrulation, embody. The first one is invagination, that is the cells moving to this region, they sink in towards the embryo. That is called sinking of the cells. Okay. Involution is the movement of cells towards the port of entry. Towards the port of entry. Then what you have? Ingression or polyinvagination, that is a group of cells separate from primary epithelial layer somewhere inside. A group of cells that they will separate and according to their fate, they will move wherever they want to go. Then next you have is a delamination, that is entire lamina of cells, they will separate and they will move. Okay, lamina is like you can move upper layer of this submica, you know submica. You can take out the submica, something like that. The entire lamina, it separates and it moves. And last one is a concrescence. It is a group of cells, like all of you, you decide whether to attend or not the lecture. A kind of mass bunking you can call or mass attendance. Okay, a group mass movement of the cells. Okay, so this is gastrulation. Okay, these are the steps. Why it is called gastrula? Okay, this was the figure I just explained you. You can see the micrometers, those are the smaller cells without yolk. Okay, they are dividing. At this region, they are coming in and moving like this. This is also initially will come here and move inside. Okay, the dorsal lip, you can call it as the Spearman organizer. Blastocyst, this is a family gastrula. In case of frog, it is a TS. By the way, the diagram is available on this website. There are fantastic illustrations on internet. If you have time, if you are interested, you can watch them. All 3D simulations. Nice YouTube video about embryology. Okay. Now, early gastrula looks like this. Late gastrula looks like this. Okay. Now, see the difference. Ectoderm has formed. Okay. Mesoderm has formed because of the coming out inside of the cells. The flow of the blastocyst, not blastocyst, now it is called gastrocyst. Blastocyst has reduced. The flow of the blastocyst is going to form endoderm. Okay, and yolk is there. Now you see the blastocyst, it has reduced. Earlier it was big. Because of the coming of the cells, a new cavity has formed. What is called a enteron? It is a fusion of two words. R is a primitive, enteron is the cavity. Okay, and it is going to form what? That in the future. It is related to gastric, that's why it is called gastrula. Clear? Now, this region, see, it is written over here. In future, it is going to form future anus. So, obviously, mouth will develop somewhere here. So this is anterior side, this is posterior side, this is dorsal side, this is ventral side. Okay. Now clear, the blastocyst has reduced, future gut has formed, 3 layers have formed, foregut, sorry, ectoderm, mesoderm and endoderm. Okay. Now late gastrula, if you take PS, how does it look? Now all of us, we are chordates. Why we are called chordates?
Presence of notochord.
Presence of notochord, right? We are, yes, we are chordate, but do we have notochord?
No.
Where it is?
In the embryonic stage.
Very good. There is a group of animals called protochordates. You get notochord present throughout the life. That is cephalochordate, urochordate, and hemichordate. okay, all of the vertebrates fish above, though they are chordate, the notochord degenerates later on, okay, but it is there in the embryonic stage, that's why we are chordates, okay. Late gastrolactic tears, it will look something like this. This is the website I have given, the link from where I have taken the picture. Now it has become triploblastic, means three layers have formed. Okay, outer is ectoderm. Okay, then you have archangelon, that is future gut. Here there is a formation of notochord. Okay, what is this? Okay, I will explain you formation of notochord briefly. Now the cells in the ectodermal region, okay, ectoderm in future is going to form nervous system, right? But somebody has to give orders. You are going to form nervous system, and those orders are issued by notochord. Okay, notochord is a solid ball of nerve-like cells. It is a solid ball. It is not hollow, not ball, a tube. Okay. Now it is formed inside the between the mesoderm and ectoderm. Okay. So this is ectoderm upper layer, and what you get here is a notochord. It is, remember, link this to previous morphogenetic movements. The cells which are going to form notochord will migrate towards this region, they will start uniting with each other and form a tube. Okay, and I told you for the chemo differentiation, the notochordal cells will have typical chemical signals which will be identified by the similar cells, they will not be identified by the blood cells. So the first cells which are going to move, let's go, I am also moving, so I will send some signal that come on, we'll go, our pet is there. So the cells will gather with me and they will move to this region and they will form the notochord. Okay. Now notochord induces the formation of brain. Okay, and brain and nervous system, and it is formed from the ectoderm. Now how it is formed, it is very interesting, very simple. The notochord sends signals to this region, and what you get is a formation of neural groove. Formation of neural groove. Groove is a kind of depression, and you get neural bridges. Okay, as the time proceeds, this goes on deepening. The groove goes on deepening. So you get something like this. Okay. Now you will get something like this. See, the ectoderm has again started covering that depression. Okay, and finally, what you will get is this gets separated from the ectoderm, and you will get the neural tube. Okay, the neural tube has been formed, below which lies the notochord. You got it? How nervous system is initiated. Okay. Now this nervous system has to be formed well before other organs are formed. The gut is formed, of course, it is in primitive stage, but always in any embryo you find the brain is always well developed. The nervous system is always well developed than any other system. What would be the logic? Why not it develops kidney first and brain up? We will see later on. Why it's not like that? It's because because brain has to take over all the activity. Okay, later on. And whenever that fetus takes birth, its all senses are to be active on the place. Okay. What you can say? Brain is the, as you said, governing body, governing center of your body. So it has to be always around when developed. So it will learn something and they will send the message. Okay. So brain has to develop, all the nervous system has to develop first and remain advanced during entire stage of development. Okay. Now, what you see here, this thickening you can see, this one. This is the middle layer, that is. Which is the middle layer?
Mesoderm,
right? And what the thickening you see at the around the notochord, it is called as somat. What?
Somat.
S-O-M-I-T, somat. Okay. It is just the thickening of cells and we have two cilomate, right? True cilomate means we have true body cavity. Now how is cavity formed? By splitting of the mesoderm. There are pseudo cilomate where cavity is not between the three layers but between endoderm and internal body layers. Whereas in true cilomate, the mesoderm actually splits. So a cavity formed by actual splitting, that is called the true cavity. Okay, now here you will see the somite, here you will see a cavity is being formed. Okay, here. And this cavity will proceed downward like this towards the ventral side. And finally, you will get mesoderm separated, two layers of mesoderm, outer ectoderm, inside mesoderm, you will find endoderm. Okay, now outer mesoderm. Adjacent to ectoderm, you can call it as a somatic mesoderm, and inner is splanchnic mesoderm. Okay, it's getting difficult. See, embryology is a real science. You have to imagine. Okay, now all the pictures, diagrams you are seeing, they are 2D. Okay, but this embryo, this is a section. But without section, you will see it is something like this. A long structure. You are seeing a section only this part. Okay. So you have got mesoderm separated. Now notochord has initiated formation of brain. Okay. Now at this stage, if you remove the notochord, the brain development halts. It doesn't form. Similar to spinal this thing, if you transplant notochord to some other region, the ectoderm in that region start forming the brain. So clearly, notochord is controlling the formation of the brain. Okay, once the brain is complete, the nervous system is formed, the notochord on itself will degenerate. Okay, so clear? From single cell zygote, you have come to three layer gastrula. Okay, ectoderm, mesoderm, endoderm. Okay, mesoderm has split. This is how neurula of the frog looks like. Now I told you the formation of nervous system. Okay, that is the stage immediately after the gastrula, and that stage is called as neurula because nervous system is formed. Here you can see the nervous, this is upper part, you can see the brain and eye developing over there. Then this is the gut, this is the notochord over here, and this is the mesoderm. Now you can see it has got anterior-posterior polarity, means now you can differentiate where is the head, where is the tail, which is the dorsal, which is the ventral. Clear? After neurula, we are not going in detail on this. After neurula, different organs they start develop. So you get epidermis nicely formed, then skeletal system, excretory system, circulatory system, reproductive system. Reproductive system develops last because it is not required for the embryo. The cells are there, but it does not reproduce. So, cells will not invest energy in formation of testes and ovary. Cells are there, and the embryo becomes older in later part of its life, they will develop. Okay, not yet. So all the systems they form. Clear? Now this is the last slide. We talk germinal layers. Okay? Ectoderm forms what?
Nervous system.
Basic nervous system. then lens of an eye, olfactory sensitive tissue, that is sensitive part of the nose, and of course the epidermis and some part of the dermis. Okay. Now look at the fate of mesoderm. It is very vital germ layer and forms so many organs of your body. Okay. Not about of course degenerate later on. Then dermal layer of the skin, that is below this thing. Then muscular system, skeletal system, circulatory system, excretory system, reproductive system in part, not entire. Then body cavity of course, and the peritoneum, that is the lining of the organs. Okay, because lining, they are rather, how you know our organs, they are in our viscera, the organs, they are floating. Okay, and they are held in a place by a peritoneum. You know that? If peritoneum is not there, we couldn't have walked, because all the heart will come down. And if you slip, you will get bulging. So something like that. So they have to be placed, held in a place by somebody, that is the peritoneum. Okay. And lastly, endoderm, primarily you get digestive tract and related organs. Okay. Then respiratory system is formed by endoderm and partly the reproductive system. Okay. So I hope I have made you clear how single cell zygote gets converted to multicellular organisms. I'm not going into the detail of it, it is indeed interesting, but it requires your full attention and full stomach and full of it. So we are not going into the detail of it, but I hope things are clear. If you have any doubts, can ask. If not, then I'll conclude. Okay, thank you very much for the listening. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.